one of the downsides of a rapidly developing country. Nurturing career dreams, several children from the countryside have flocked to the cities. They rank among the most neglected and disadvantaged. 16-year-old Thai from Hanoi suburbs is one of them. Receiving minimal education, no parental guidance, and struggling to survive from city violence, Thai is on a one-way trip to self-destruction. The situation, thankfully, is bound to change, for one charitable organization based in Australia has sought to empower street kids by giving them education and professional training. Koto.
Now, for many youths, disadvantaged youths and philanthropists, as well as visitors here in Vietnam, Koto has become a very popular name. Koto, which also means know one, teach one, is an organization that seeks to basically provide the necessary skills to youths basically living in disadvantaged conditions, coming from disadvantaged background, for them to pursue the successful path that they dream of. So in our talk Vietnam today, we actually have the founder of Koto here with us. His name is Jimmy Pham, and he'll share with us basically his idea, how it came about, and why he's so passionate about it. So please join me in welcoming Jimmy Pham.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jimmy, for joining us. How are you today?
It's a pleasure, and I'm actually not feeling completely 100%, but I'll give my 100%.
Awesome. Yeah. Now, I read an article as we were finding out more about you that you described yourself as being irrational and ambitious. So tell us a little bit more about yourself.
Sure. I think it's I'm described as a social entrepreneurial, and social entrepreneur around the world is a bit of a movement currently, and they call it is unreasonable, and I guess I add the ambition. Ambitions would in, because I'm very focused on where I'm going. Main focus is the kids themselves, which is my driving force. It's about them. The reason why you wake up in the morning and you go to work and you go through, you face many, many challenges. But at the end of the day, you see that smile and you see them in secure jobs and in turn helping someone else, then you feel that you've it's worth it.
Exactly. Going back to, you said 10 years, around 1999, 2000, how did the idea come about?
I came to Vietnam because I was raised in Australia, and I'm half Vietnamese and half Korean. And I came back to Vietnam in 1996, so it's 3 years before that. Mm-hmm. And on a chance encounter with a couple of street kids in Ho Chi Minh City that ultimately changed the course of my path. These kids were a bold noodle soup to tell me their stories of lost dreams and unable to sort of like break the cycle of poverty. I've taken them and 60 other kids to dinner, and then at that time, I don't know what came over me, but I sat down on the pavement on the plastic stool. In those days, I can sit on the plastic stool. and realized that, hey, I can make a difference, and the focus was that I can make a difference, and I did that. I went back to Australia, and 4 months later I came back to Vietnam, working in a capacity to earn a job, get a job, mm-hmm. and to earn some money to support these kids that I so passionately devoted to, and Koto started from a promise of those same kids that I'll help them find a better tomorrow.
Right. So tell us more about the details of this concept. You bring these children, youths in, and you're providing the skills, but what specifically is the concept?
The concept of Koto is they say that's 50% vocational training, which is the skills they're going to need in order to have sustainability in their life. The other 50% is to be able to create self-esteem and confidence, that they'd be able to sort of resolve problems and issues that they may face along the way. Mm-hmm. By having a family structure, they have values and they have principles and they have a structure. So when they have that combining with vocational training, that seems to have a holistic skill development.
So tell us a little bit about the center in Hanoi. I know that that was the first one, and the first course began in, I believe, 1999.
That's right.
How did it get started up? Were there a lot of challenges?
I've been looking after a whole bunch of kids for 3 years, and then I did an old Chinese proverb of give a man a fish today, and he'll eat them today, and not able to show them how to fish. So they pulled me aside one day, and they said to me, look, we trust you now. But the way you're looking, you looked after us is not the way that you looked after us. We're going to need a job. We're going to need something a bit more sustainable. So mm-hmm. I thought that everyone needs to eat, and hospitality seems to be the most transferable skills you can give someone who have an academic qualification only to up to grade 4, grade 5. So the concept at the beginning was just to give them security, a steady flow of income, and the skills training. And then over the last 10 years, it's kind of developed much more than that.
Exactly. And the first course, how many people were in that course?
The very first koto was 9 kids. Mm-hmm. And then a year later, we had 20 kids. Mm-hmm. And then it grew from 20 to 30 to 40 and then 70. And then that was 100 kids in the program. Yeah.
In the first course, did you yourself teach them? Did you have help from other people?
I remember pulling out a whiteboard and just going through a Women's Day cookbook. And try and teach them just basic stuff on ingredients. But over time, very lucky, a year later, we had this one fantastic woman who's actually still living in Hanoi. Her name's Tracy Lister. And she helped me to develop a curriculum and eventually taught the kids how to cook and have a proper curriculum. So,
Jimmy Pham's encounter with Vietnamese street children in 1996 paved the way for Koto's extraordinary journey. In 1999, Jimmy gathers 9 befriended street youths, opens a sandwich shop, and registers Koto as a professional charitable training program. The following 6 years witnessed a boom in international funding, volunteer agencies' involvement, and the setting up of a rigorous kitchen, life skills, and English curriculum from Box Hill TAFE Training School in Australia. Media coverage becomes extensive, and Koto graduates' success stories are known worldwide. The new Koto restaurant opens in 2007, the same year Jimmy Pham receives the James Strong Leadership Award and hands over operations to a local Hanoi CEO to become Koto International CEO. Koto plans on future financial self-efficiency and expansion to new cities and nations in the goal to change ever more street lives, like today graduate Pham.
How did you come up with the concept, Koto? You said no one, teach one.
I had a very special person. He's my class graduate, class 1. And he got sick one day, and then we took him to the hospital, and it was the first time that he actually had to stay overnight. And when he got better, he said to me, you know, he looked at me straight in the eye, and he said, what do you want from all this? Why are you so good to us? You know, 3 years of loyalty and care, pastoral care, there must be something that you want from all this. And to be honest, I wasn't able to give him a proper answer because I don't even know why I was doing the things I do. I just know that I wanted to help. So 3 months later, I came back to him and said, do you remember what you asked me? And he said, yes. And I said, well, I want you to become the best person that you can be. All the dreams that you often talk to me about, I want you to be able to fulfill that. But then I want you to be able to pay it forward and help someone else. And knowing that person breathed a bit easier because you've lived, then that's the meaning of success to me.
Right. And now, tell us a little bit about the trainees. Throughout the years, you've obviously had some unforgettable memories. Can you name a few?
Where this particular Hill Tribe person, and he was brought up to believe that he's a Hill Tribe. Mm-hmm. An ethnic minority, and when he grew up, he found that his features are actually quite different to the feature of his mom, who brought him up. And then he discovered he's actually not a Hill Tribe person at all, but actually someone that he was, when he was abandoned as a baby, he was taken care of. But the story is this: he came to Koto, and for him and a few of his friends, they never able to ever sleep on the bed before. On his birthday, he woke up one morning to find a very small cupcake right next to his bed, which all his friends pretended they were sleeping, but they weren't. They wanted to see his reaction. So he looked around the room, and he couldn't. He thought everyone was sleeping. He quietly cried for a little bit. And that whole day, he carried that little piece of cake with him. It's a cupcake. He wouldn't put it in his briefcase. He wouldn't eat them. And when asked why he wouldn't eat them, he said, "This is the first time you actually have a birthday." And he's 19 years old. So I think I feel very proud, because for 400 kids now, I can tell you every names, where they are, what they're doing. And I get invited to birthdays and weddings, and when they have their first kid. So I think it's very special.
Biên Thị Liên from Hà Tĩnh Central Province passed through scathing family tragedies prior to Koto. Orphaned since the age of 4, Liên moved to live with her grandparents, consecutively witnessing the deaths of her grandmother and father. The Koto application was initially made for her brother before tragedy ensued.
Khi chờ kết quả ở Koto lâu quá thì gia đình em đã cố gắng cho anh em đi học. Thì trên đường đi học không may anh em bị tai nạn và qua đời. Đấy là cái cú sốc mà nó gây cho em mất đi nhiều cái tinh thần. Em cảm tưởng như em không thể sống tiếp được nữa. Tại vì từ lúc bố mẹ em mất, em luôn xem anh em là một người giống như là người bố trong nhà, luôn chỉ bảo và dạy dỗ cho em. Nhưng khi mà anh mất rồi thì em cảm giác như nó hụt hẫng, không có người để em chia sẻ, không có người để em tâm sự. Nhưng thật may mắn là em đã có gia đình cô tôi.
Things have changed. Koto kitchen courses gave Liên professional skills and restored her shattered self-esteem. Liên now feels comfortable dealing with her painful past and sharing her inner thoughts. She even looks forward to opening a small restaurant of her own upon graduation. At Koto, trainees are given a solid foundation of professional training and personality construction. Whether taking English courses, kitchen training, or allowed to give their imagination free rein in this flower arrangement session, all trainees aim to overcome their difficulties and become independent, responsible citizens.
I think that the students here at Koto are very different from a lot of other students in different schools. A lot of them have to stop studying to work a long time ago to support their family. A lot of them even forget Vietnamese. So teaching English is a bit difficult for them, and it's required that the teacher should be patient and sensitive and share with them the difficulty. So, I think that one of the rewards here as a teacher here is that they try very hard. They try very hard, realize their opportunities, and try to change the future.
Intense training sessions, all in English, for an internationally recognized certificate. Koto pushes its trainees to the maximum of their potentials in the goal to empower these one street kids to overcome their hardships and positively contribute to society.
Amongst the different techniques, skills that these youths learn, you said there's cooking, there's normal hospitality skills. What are some of the other skills that they learn?
Two main skills that we vocational training is the front of house and kitchen, which is accredited by a Box Hill Institute in Melbourne, Australia. Mm-hmm. This accreditation has allowed these kids to not only work in Vietnam in some of the top five-star hotels and restaurants, but they're also able to work overseas as well. Number two is the English specifically for the hospitality, which is they've embraced this and they're able to sort of pronounce it properly, and they think English, they speak English, and they write English, which is good. And the last one is the personal and the life skill development. We run a whole series of workshop on stress management, to anger management, to healthy relationship, to budgeting, all the way to sports, health, adolescent reproductive health as well, to community services, green projects on the environment, and give them all the necessity that they're going to need, the information, so when they leave us, they leave us as responsible and the informed adult.
Exactly. Now, among the when they do leave you, what are some of the opportunities that they are they encounter?
Wow, the opportunity is endless. We have a lot of kids working at Five Star. Five Star seems to be the hot thing at the moment. So they end up working at a lot of the Five Star, because of course Vietnam now resorts and hotels are popping up everywhere in Vietnam. So opportunity endless for them. International restaurants, opportunity to study overseas. We have a few of our kids are already in Australia as well. Their work experience in Paris and Holland and Switzerland and all that as well. So they have a great opportunity. And we want to further that in the future, where we'll be able to sort of offer them further training and support through the alumni program, so they're able to have that consistency.
I understand that each recruitment session, you recruit around 30 youths. How many candidates are there in the beginning?
We, every 6 months or so, we recruit 30 students from both Hanoi and Saigon as well. Out of that, the ratio is 1 in 7 will get a place. The recruitment process, unfortunately, is a rigorous one. They go through a four-stage process where we determine they are who they say they are, that they're the most disadvantaged and they need our help. They have a good attitude because they want to change. And finally, they're able to adapt to the environment as well. We don't say that we're an answer to all street kids' problems and vocational training here in Vietnam, but those precious fields that we do help, that we're able to get them through the program and into a job, and then breaking the cycle of poverty.
Exactly. Now, but for the criteria, it's basically youths who can be able to adapt to the environment and also have disadvantageous situations. Where often do you seek these candidates? Do they find you, or do you find them?
We work with a lot of organizations that work with street kids, also juvenile delinquent centers and centers, institutions that a lot of the kids end up from crime or from, you know, different sorts of prostitutions, drugs, etc. We also work with outreach organizations as well that goes to the forefront, where they meet a lot of the street kids as well. And our kids are actually the biggest ambassador for us, because they're the one who goes and recommend to the program to other kids that remind them of themselves. And in actual fact, because they, I guess, nothing is more credible than someone who used to be where they are saying that, look, trust me, because I've done this, I've gone through the program.
Among the 400 graduates, are there any success story that you're particularly proud of? I mean, I'm sure you're all proud. You're proud of all of your 400 siblings, but any particular success story that sticks to your mind?
Do you know, I have graduates that now study in Australia, and she's doing her advanced diploma, and then she's going to do her degree this year at RMIT. We have kids that are going to university. We have kids who are in the managerial positions at hotels and restaurants. Like Mr. Kwang here owns his own business now, and he's very sought after in the setup of bars and restaurants now as well. And Ms. Hoon, someone who just, you know, all she wanted was to study. And recently she passed level 7 in IELTS, which is incredible achievement for someone who just don't have that opportunity. But when given an opportunity, they embrace it with both hands and with passion.
Thanks. Well, now talking about the success stories of Cultural Training Center, we'll meet some of them in the following, so take a look.
Class 9 graduate Đặng Thị Hương today is head of Dragon Cultural Training House, providing a home for trainees who used to have none. Affectionately called House Mother, Hương guides her interns and tutors them on assignments. Prior to Koto, Hương made her way through tremendous hardships, just like the interns today under her care, having to struggle for years to balance food sales and in-service training away from home. Her success story is an inspiring example, reminding the trainees to stay on track in all endeavors.
Điều quan trọng lớn nhất mà em vẫn thường nói với các em là mình luôn luôn phải biết mình đang ở đâu và mình đang làm cái gì và cái mục đích trong tương lai của mình là gì. Và cái điều lớn thứ hai mà em luôn muốn truyền đạt đến các em là luôn luôn phải sống sống thật lòng với bản thân mình và có cái sự đóng góp lại cho Cô Tô. Ngoài cái việc là em nhận cái sự hỗ trợ từ Cô Tô thì em cần phải đóng góp lại cho Cô Tô bằng việc lớn nhất là bằng cách là cố gắng học tập rất là tốt và thương yêu nhau. Thì đấy là cái và đó cũng là cái yếu tố rất là lớn để có thể thành công sau khi mà tốt nghiệp.
Em cảm thấy khi được vào Cô Tô và khi được vào nhà Cô Tô là một may mắn rất lớn đối với bọn em và với tất cả các bạn. Bởi vì khi chúng em chưa vào đây thì chúng em vẫn là những đứa trẻ đường phố, đánh giày hoặc là làm những công việc nặng nhọc bên ngoài. Tất cả các bạn đến đây đều có một cái hoàn cảnh chung, đấy là sự thiếu thốn về tình cảm hoặc là về vật chất. Đến khi vào đây thì chúng em cùng cảnh với nhau và chúng em chia sẻ được những cái nỗi niềm với nhau, chúng em động viên nhau và chúng em cố gắng học tập. Đấy là cái niềm vui và cái cố gắng của bọn em.
Enjoying a higher profile is class 2 graduate Nguyễn Quang Quân, whose bar Q-Pop in Lương Ngọc Huyền Street of Hanoi has been an attractive social gathering for both Vietnamese and expats. Once a homeless porter at night markets, Quang's interest in cocktail and graphic design guided him during his Koto studies, motivating him to start his own bar upon graduation. Q-Cup is the third and so far the most successful of Quang's efforts.
Em chỉ có một chút cái chia sẻ cái kinh nghiệm của mình tới những bạn học sinh ở trường và những bạn trẻ em nghèo khó khăn ở cả nước hiện tại, là chúng ta lên sống có niềm tin và chúng ta trong cái quá trình để đi tới thành công là có sự chịu khó và chăm chỉ học hỏi.
As Koto is keen on expanding to new cities in Vietnam, success stories like those of Hương and Quang will continue to inspire ever more disadvantaged adolescents nationwide.
So in our studio today, we actually have two graduates from the Koto Training Center. We're very lucky to have them here with us today. The first is Đặng Thị Hương, and the second is Nguyễn Quang Quang. Thank you very much for joining us here today. We know that you're both graduates, so let's start with you, Hương. Can you introduce a little bit about yourself?
Em tên là Đặng Thị Hương ạ. Em năm nay 24 tuổi và em đến từ Vĩnh Phúc ạ.
Okay, and how about you, Quang? Can you introduce yourself?
Chào chị và chào chương trình Talk Việt Nam. Tên em là Nguyễn Quang Quang, em đến từ Hà Tây. Năm nay em 31 tuổi và em là khóa 2 của Cô Tô.
Wonderful. Now, Quang, can you tell us a little bit about your life before coming to the Cultural Training Center?
Vâng, cái cuộc sống trước kia của em khi mà chưa vào Cô Tô thì là những cái năm đầu tiên từ quê ra Hà Nội rất là khó khăn. Cũng đã phải sống và ngủ ở ngoài chợ 2-3 ngày và cái công việc cũng chỉ mong tìm được một công việc để hỗ trợ cho gia đình ở quê. Thì em cũng may mắn là gặp được một số các cô chú buôn bán ở chợ cũng rất là tốt, đã tạo điều kiện cho em có một cái công việc làm ở ngoài chợ.
What did you do specifically?
Em làm rất nhiều việc, làm công việc về hỗ trợ cho các bác về vận chuyển hàng hóa và dọn dẹp vệ sinh và đi đưa hàng các thứ.
For Hương, how old were you when you came to Hanoi? I know that you came also when you were really young.
Yeah. Lúc em mới lần đầu tiên em xuống Hà Nội lúc đấy là em 13 tuổi rưỡi ạ. Thì công việc đầu tiên mà em làm khi em xuống Hà Nội đó là em có một người quen ở cùng quê dẫn xuống và đi làm giúp việc, và công việc đầu tiên của em là trông một em bé 4 tháng tuổi. Sau trong suốt 5 năm đầu ở Hà Nội thì em có thay đổi một số công việc như là đi làm ở quán cơm, đi bán hàng bánh mì và đi bán hàng tạp hóa, cũng là bán thuê. Gia đình em thì rất là nghèo và bố em bị bệnh từ khi mà bọn em còn nhỏ, và bố em thì có một gia đình khác nữa, và mẹ em một mình nuôi ba anh em lớn. Khi đó thì anh em học rất là tốt và em phải nghỉ học để cho anh em học tiếp. Và hàng tháng thì cái số tiền mà em thu được lúc đó thì là 150.000 một tháng, và cái số tiền đó thì em để dành cho mẹ chữa bệnh và có thể hỗ trợ anh trai em và em gái em nữa. Sau 5 năm thì em quyết định là em không thể tiếp tục một cái công việc mãi như thế được. Và bởi vì là em rất là thích học. Sau đó thì em có một người giới thiệu em xuống trung tâm giáo dục thường xuyên quận Cầu Giấy. Thì là em xuống đó em học học bổ túc buổi tối á. Thì cái lúc đầu rất là khó khăn, bởi vì là cái gia đình mà người ta cho em ở trong đó ấy, mà người ta cho em làm giúp việc ạ, thì người ta không có hài lòng khi mà em đi học buổi tối và ban ngày chỉ làm ban ngày. Thì họ gây rất là nhiều cái khó dễ cho em. Và em nhớ là cái hôm đó là rất là rét và em bị đuổi ra ngoài. Sau đó thì em cũng không biết làm gì cả, bởi vì là em không muốn nghỉ học. Thì lúc đó mẹ em cũng nói là mẹ cũng không muốn cho em ở ngoài Hà Nội, bởi vì nếu mà em ở ngoài như thế rất là vất vả ấy. Và em quyết tâm em không quay về, bởi vì là em rất là muốn đi học. Nếu như em về quê thì em sẽ không có cơ hội đi học tiếp. Sau đó thì em có đi xin một số nơi, một số công việc khác ấy. Thì em vào rất là nhiều cái trung tâm dịch vụ việc làm ấy. Và họ lừa em rất là nhiều lần, và để họ lấy cái tiền phí đó, và họ không hề xin việc cho em. Rất là may là đến năm lớp 11, giữa năm lớp 11 thì em có quen một chị ở cùng cái lớp bổ túc với em ấy. Thì chị đã từng apply vào Cô Tô rồi ạ, và chị chỉ nói qua với em là em có muốn đi học không. Em cũng không hình dung Cô Tô là gì, và em cũng lúc đó em cũng không hy vọng là có thể vào được một nơi nào đó, bởi vì là trước đó em xin việc rất nhiều mà em cảm thấy là em không có lòng tin vào bất cứ ai ở đó nữa hết. Em còn nhớ cái cảm giác đầu tiên mà em đạp xe xuống đường Thụy Khuê ạ. Thì trước khi em vào đến Cô Tô, em đứng ở ngoài và em thở một hơi rất là dài. Và em nghĩ rằng là không biết là ở đây có tốt như là người ta nói hay không. Sau đó thì em vào thì ấn tượng đầu tiên của em là một chị nhân sự, và chị giới thiệu cho em rất là cặn kẽ về Cô Tô ạ. Sau đó thì em được nhận vào Cô Tô, và em còn nhớ rất là rõ là hôm đó em đang đi học buổi tối bổ túc, và người nhà em gọi điện xuống và tự dưng em chạy ra sân trường và em gào thét lên và mọi người không hiểu là đang có vấn đề gì xảy ra ấy. Thế sau
Very
sau
excited basically to get into Koto. What were you, when you came to Koto, you said you had a really long sigh, and then after that you went in. What happened?
Cái chị ở phòng nhân sự ạ, thì chị cầm cái tờ giấy ra và chị cười rất là tươi và tự dưng làm cho em cảm thấy là nó có một cái gì đó rất là khác so với ở ngoài. Sau đó chị hướng dẫn em rất là tận tình về Cô Tô, giải thích cho em Cô Tô là gì và hướng dẫn cho em cách làm hồ sơ. Thì lúc lúc đó thì em mới thực sự là yên tâm ấy, là mình sẽ không bị lừa.
Now before we continue with your experience with Koto, let's go back to Quang. Now we've heard the Ahung story and all the difficulties she's had to overcome. What were some of the challenges for you when you were younger and basically living in Hanoi for the very first time?
Em cũng có một cái hoàn cảnh riêng của gia đình mình là bố mẹ ở quê cũng rất là khó khăn, nhà có ba anh em. Thì bố em thì có rất là tốt, nhưng mà ông có một vấn đề rằng là về cái vấn đề về nghiện rượu với cả đánh cờ bạc. Trong cái hai cái vấn đề đó thì bố em đã gần như là đã lát một cân bạc và gần như là không 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 thể sống ở làng nữa, phải đi một nơi khác để sống. Thì trong cái quá trình đó thì ba mẹ con rất là khó khăn, chỉ mong sao là mình đi đâu đó và kiếm được công việc gì đó để làm để hỗ trợ cho mẹ thêm. Thì trong cái quá trình đó thì em cũng chỉ biết là đi theo những người lớn, là đi ra xe và ngồi lên xe và chạy trên xe đó và cũng không biết là cái xe đó đi tới đâu cả. Cái xe đã đỗ ở cái bến cuối cùng là bến Long Biên. Thì em cũng đã xuống tới đó và cũng không có một người thân và không quen ai cả. Em cũng đã tìm kiếm và hỏi han những người lớn hơn để có thể mình làm được cái gì đó, mình kiếm một cái gì đó để ăn hàng ngày trước. Cũng không nghĩ rằng là mình có thể kiếm một cái công việc hay là ai đó cho mình một công việc ổn định gì cả. Sau khi từ cái chợ Long Biên em chuyển về chợ Châu Long và trở về chợ bởi vì em cũng có đưa hàng, một số hàng về chợ Châu Long. Thì qua về chợ Châu Long thì có một cô chú ở đó là mối hàng của một bà chủ ở chợ Châu Long thôi ạ, cũng rất là tốt và đã ngỏ ý với em rằng là về làm cho cô chú ấy thì cô chú sẽ có nhà các thứ cho mình ở. Ở trong cái gia đình mà em ở, cả cô chú đó thì có một người bạn của hai vợ chồng đó, thì chú ấy làm cái công ty du lịch. Vâng, thì chú đã rất là, mọi người rất là quý mến em và cũng hỏi em là em có cái hướng là muốn đi học một cái gì đó không. Thì lúc đó thì em chỉ nói với cả chú là cháu rất thích làm nghề về làm trong công việc trong khách sạn. Thì sau đó chú về chú nói chuyện với em. Và chú nói chuyện với em và nói với em qua thử cô tô xem như thế nào. Chú cũng nói rất rõ rằng là đây là thực sự là hoàn cảnh khó khăn, chứ không phải là ai muốn xin vào cũng được.
So, Hương, could you, before telling us what you're currently doing now, how do you think Koto has changed your life?
Từ khi em vào Koto thì cái đầu tiên mà em thấy rất là tự hào đó là cái em trở thành một người tự tin hơn rất là nhiều. Và khi mà em tốt nghiệp xong thì em rất là tự hào với cái bằng mà Koto trao cho em. Và em cũng rất là tự tin khi mà ra ngoài làm việc. Sau đó thì em làm, em ra ngoài và em xin được Koto hỗ trợ em một công việc rất là tốt. Đó là làm ở trong khách sạn Intercontinental Hà Nội Westlake. Và em có thể so sánh được cái sự khác biệt rất lớn khi mà em có đầy đủ kỹ năng và bằng cấp. Thì cái công việc của em nó khác như thế nào so với cái lúc mà em chưa vào Koto ạ.
I can definitely say from hearing both of your stories that they're very inspiring to anyone who's struggling out there, whether it be a child wandering off the streets or just a normal person trying to struggle with everyday life. Well, thank you very much for coming on to the show and sharing your stories with us. And may you be very successful in your endeavor, and you will continue to be a big part of the Koto family. Thank you. Now, I heard that Koto has also has a restaurant. Tell us a little bit about this restaurant. When did it get started up?
This restaurant is, we moved there about 3 years ago. Mm-hmm. We were told 61 Van Mill that is no longer available. And we've kind of outgrown that, by the way, because we wanted to increase the number of trainees that we're able to help. And the 1.5 floor is not going to be able to do that. So there began the journey of trying to build a better home for Koto. It took us about a year to look everywhere in Hanoi, and finally we moved right next door. So I guess it was meant for Koto always to be around the temporal literature area. We're very lucky. We had the APEC at that time. So we had Miss Laura Bush, the former First Lady, yes, and also Jeanette Howard, who's the Prime Minister of Australia's wife. Mm-hmm. They closed Koto on the last day, and then we have the Australian Ambassador open Koto, a new Koto, the following month.
Wow, so I guess that's how its popularity got risen, basically.
I think the popularity, I think it's a lot of word to mouth. Mm-hmm. When people walked in, as I comment before, is the comment is like walking into a chamber of energy. Mm-hmm. And we never became reliant on, please feel sorry for us because we're a charity and sorry for the bad food and the bad service. But we work really, really hard, all of us, to make sure that Koto is built on its own credibility and its own merit. And every single kid is like you're walking into their own home And in Vietnam, food and family is everything. And it's important for them to, so when you walk into their family, that you get treated right and you have a good meal.
So the most appealing thing basically for visitors is walking, especially for foreign visitors or in a foreign land, walking into a space where they feel very warm and welcoming.
That's right.
And if the trainees work within this restaurant as well alongside their other courses, they're the one who prepare the meal, is that right?
We have about 10% of our staff are graduates, so they're from trainers to staff at the restaurants and at the training center as well. So they're the one who's got, like, the No One Teach One that's been Echo, the Big Brother, the Big Sister, where they teach the trainees in the kitchen and also in the service area. But most of 80 to 90% of the students you see at the restaurants are actually trainees who's in training.
Koto Restaurant on 59 Văn Miếu Street, the flagship restaurant for Hanoi's Koto trainees, where their intensive training bears fruit. Inaugurated in 2007, the restaurant is proof of the changes made by the trainees throughout their studies at Koto. Highly appreciated by expats throughout Vietnam, Koto Restaurant not only provides diverse, tasty meals, but also sends a message of joining hands to make positive changes.
I think they do a wonderful job here. I keep coming back and recommending all my friends that come and visit because it's a friendly, happy, relaxed environment.
It's really fantastic to be able to give the street kids a go. It's not just learning about the cooking and the preparation of the food and the waiting. It's being given life skills as well, hygiene checks and everything that makes them a better person for their own futures.
Văn Miếu Koto Restaurant allows graduates from earlier classes to take leadership positions and pass on their skills to younger trainees. The cycle continues, ensuring that all graduates continue to help those coming from similarly difficult backgrounds.
Đối với công việc của em ở đây, em cảm thấy rất là vui bởi vì là em cũng là học sinh ra trường ở Koto và thứ hai nữa là bây giờ thì là em có cái cơ hội để chỉ dẫn lại cho các em cũng có cái hoàn cảnh như em ngày xưa ấy, và để sau này mà ra trường có thể có một cái công việc nó tốt, có thể là tốt như em hoặc có thể là hơn em.
The cultural graduates pictured at this gallery have taken on different paths in life. Their success today, either in cultural-based institutions or independent businesses, both inspires future trainees and serves as a reminder to maintain their ties with the Koto family.
We talked a lot about the trainees. What about the trainers? Where did they come from?
The trainers, at the moment, we're very proud to say that after 10 years or so, we have a lot of capacity building. So the trainers actually graduates from the program. We also have a wonderful English teacher who oversees all the training as well. She's been with us for about nearly 10 years now. I think when you call them trainers, you also call them big brothers and sisters as well. So because it's like a family, you have to put on a lot of hats. And when you're a trainer, you also put a hat of a big sister and a big brother as well. And that's how they learn, is by not only by making mistakes, but be able to build a relationship.
Right. And you have wonderful graduates like her who came back now to help out and to be a trainer herself.
Absolutely. She actually, Ms. Hương, has been offered a scholarship to Australia.
Wow.
So she's actually off to Australia next year.
Congratulations.
As well. So yeah, so she's very looking forward to that. And I think, you know, it's her dream to be able to get a tertiary and university qualification. And it's amazing that, yes, she took a detour along the way, but she got there eventually because now she can have her dream, but her family is well taken care of. And Koto is very, very blessed to have her.
Now looking to the future, I know Koto now has a branch not only in Hanoi, but also in Ho Chi Minh City. What are some of the future plans?
Wow, the future plan is completely open. To get true sustainability, we have to build a school. So that's the next goal for Koto. Number two is we want to be able to open a further education courses where a lot of our graduates, alumni, can go and have further study in management and different areas as well. We want to open a Koto in Cambodia, mm-hmm. and maybe maybe Australia. I guess the model seems to work, and we've come up with a good formula that's that basically, you know, where we say that there's an abandon, there's a neglect, and there's the abuse, Koto will be there.
Mm-hmm. Well, we wish you the best of luck in continuing to be the daika, the big brother, for Thank all you. Of your 400 and even more to come siblings. Brothers and sisters, thank you very much for joining us today on Talk Vietnam, sharing your stories with us, and we wish you the best of luck.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And that is it for this edition of Talk Vietnam. We talked with Jimmy Fatman, also some of his very distinguished trainees, his brothers and sisters. That is it for this edition of Talk Vietnam. Bye.